I want to thank for the invitation, for the chance to speak in the seminar. It's really an honor, and to say greetings from Athens to everyone. So I will be reporting on it's really work in progress. I should stress this, and it's me and Eric Van Erp and Omar and Omar Mohsen and Bob Junken. So yeah, so let me tell you what we've been thinking during the last few months or 1 year perhaps. Okay, so I'll start with a little bit of history. So this story started really from Kolmogorov, as far as I know. I think Kolmogorov was looking at Brownian motion, and he came up with these operators in R3 and R2. And then Hermander proved this theorem, which says, the question is, when are these operators hypoelliptic? So this Hermander gave a proof in 1967 of the following fact, that if you have a bunch of vector fields and you have a sum of squares operators, but you allow an extra term which is not a square, in fact, and you take this D here is, I mean, the module generated, the C infinity M module generated by these vector fields. This is modern way of thinking. Maybe it was not stated exactly like this. And then you take the iterated brackets. Then if they generate the whole tangent bundle.
Sorry, is it a typo, xj j squared or just xj squared?
Yeah, it's a typo, thank you. It's xj squared. Yeah, the second j should not be there. Thank you. Mm-hmm. So if they generate all the vector fields, then Hermander was able to prove using PDE's methods that this operator is hypoelliptic. So in the first example, you can see the vector fields involved. It's the red one and the blue one. And just notice that just notice that the lead bracket gives you dy. And then Malyavin gave a second proof in the 70s using calculus of variations, which is, I think it's in fashion today in stochastics, but I will not speak about this today. Okay, so where do we come in? The questions we want to ask is, this is a pretty general theorem for sums of squares operators, but we wanted to address the hypoellipticity of other linear differential operators as well, beyond sum of squares, and to ask if we can do index theory with them and if we can construct the parametrics. Another point is not just other operators. Another point is that in R2, this operator in R2 is quite singular. So there is this x dx, there's a vanishing at the y axis somehow. Of course, Hermander was able to overcome this singularity in his proof, but if we want, I mean, there is a singularity involved in this business. Okay, so let me be a little bit more specific. What we want, if you want to address parametrics problems, usually you need the pseudo-differential calculus where you can build the parametrics in. And we need a principal symbol, of course, for this differential operator. So I should say that the principal symbol is for the differential operators. Okay, this was achieved in some cases later by all these people whose names you can read. For step two sums of squares operators, there is a grading and there is a step two grading. They are similar to the examples I gave before, and but without singularity. So there is, So what happens is that the symbol lives in a step two nilpotent group. It's a function on a step two nilpotent group in this case. I mean, the model is the Heisenberg group, of course. And people were able to prove that this so-called Rockland, it was a conjecture, but then it was proven that the principle, if the principal symbol is invertible in every representation of this group, then the operator is hypoelliptic. It's actually Fredholm. But all of this doesn't hold for the Kolmogorov operator in R2 because of the singularity. Okay, and then some more work came up. Very recently, there is work by Melin and very recently by Eric Van Erp and Robert Junken, where they extended actually this Heisenberg calculus to higher step sum of squares operators, but still without singularities. So this uses the viewpoint about pseudo-differential operators of Claire Debord and Georges Kandalis that I will explain in a few slides later. This uses the formation groupoids. So we have to introduce groupoids to make sense of this. But let me give you an overview. So you have an operator and you look at the terms and you look at the order of the terms. And the order of the terms gives you a Lie filtration. So Lie means that the bracket, you have a filtration and you have that this relation about the bracket. And then you can take the associated grading. The associated grading is in fact a bundle of nilpotent Lie algebra. It's always nilpotent because of the relation with the bracket. And the symbol of these operators that was built, the calculus that was built, is it lives on the osculating Lie group bundle. It's the Lie group bundle that integrates this Lie algebra, this bundle of Lie algebra, sorry. So it's this fat GRD. Okay, so this is very generic, it's not many details. So let me tell you what we want to do. We want to generalize this calculus so that it applies to arbitrary linear differential operators, well, if possible, including singular ones. So it means that we want to define, so what does this mean? That we want to be able to define the principal symbol of differential operators as such on oscillating groups, these nilpotent groups, but we don't want them to be constant on the dimension to be constant on every point. We want to allow the dimension to vary. I will explain later how this comes up, but this is really the singularity. And we want to give a Rockland theorem for this in this context. Okay, so what is our strategy? The strategy has three ingredients. One is the notion of distributions transverse to a submersion by Lescure, Manchon, and Vassoud. It is, of course, the Debord-Kandalis viewpoint on the differential calculus. And another ingredient that comes in is singular foliations. It's foliation theory. So we recast the problem to foliation theory in order to be able to build that and to understand it from this point of view. So I will actually half of this talk will be about examples. I try to illustrate all of this through examples, and then after a while we'll start being more strict. Okay. So let me tell you about the first ingredient. What does it mean to have distributions transverse to submersion? So let's say we have a surjective submersion. A distribution transverse to the submersion is a C infinity M linear map from C infinity N to C infinity M, very roughly. Of course, C infinity N is a C infinity M module. So that's what this means. So for example, just if you take the projection from the Cartesian product to M, but now I see the Cartesian product as a pair groupoid really. And if you start with a vector field, how do you see it as a distribution transverse to this projection? Well, you have to notice that the tangent bundle is actually the kernel of this projection. And the kernel of this projection is the normal bundle of the unit inclusion map. The unit is just the diagonal inclusion of M in M cross M. So in fact, you can see the value of a vector, the point as something lying in the tangent space at the unit of this groupoid. The unit is again P comma P of this groupoid. So you get a very nice linear map like that, which is, well, what you see here. And in fact, this can be generalized to any, the sections of any Lie algebraoid, because we know that any, the sections of a Lie algebraoid is a right invariant vector field on the groupoid. So in a similar way, we can associate the distribution to it. Okay. Now, what about the second ingredient? So I will try to illustrate the viewpoint of Claire Debord and Zoros Kardalis. So the idea is that if you, what do you need for a pseudo-differential calculus? Actually, you need the deformation groupoid plus an action of R plus star. So what is the action for? The action is because we really want the pseudo-differential calculus to be invariant by diffeomorphism, and this can be formulated in terms of an action of R plus star. So how do groupoids come up? Well, if you have any pseudo-differential operators, it's really determined by Schwarz kernel. And this is a distribution. So you can actually realize this distribution as one of these distributions that I mentioned before, fibered on the projection, if you want, in the simplest case. And then you look at this deformation groupoid. This is the deformation normal cone introduced by Alain Cohn. The idea comes from algebraic geometry, but this is known in very well known in the work of Alain Cohn and other people, of course. And there is an action of R plus star, which is defined in this way that I explained here. Sorry. Okay, now Eric and Bob, Eric van Erp and Robert Juncken were able to prove the following theorem in a recent paper of theirs, that they, when is a distribution actually the Schwarz kernel of a pseudo-differential operator of order M properly supported? Well, it is so if and only if, this is really an if and only if result, it is the restriction to one, to t equals one, of some distribution on the deformation normal cone. And where is the order? The order is in the homogeneity of this homogeneity property, is the order of so the alpha lambda star is the push forward of the of this action. So this is, if you want, the point of view that works for us, for pseudo-differential operators that works for us. Okay, now let's give an example. How can we view a single vector field as an order one pseudo-differential operator? Well, it works like this. This is where foliation theory comes in, where you see it for the first time, I mean. So if you start with just this vector field on M, and then you extend it to M times R in this way. So this is really a family which is constant on TM. It's zero on TM, and then everywhere else it's, you just dilate. And then you notice that M times R with T times XM, T times XM means all these vector fields that you construct like this, is really a foliation. It has a singularity, but it has singularities, but they are quite mild. They are what is called almost regular. This is the term coined by Claire Debord. And you look at the holonomy groupoid. Actually, the holonomy groupoid is the deformation to the normal cone. So this groupoid is really a holonomy groupoid. And what is its algebraoid? Well, the algebraoid, its sections is this foliation. It's exactly this foliation. Okay. Now, So we're not finished. So now you can define a distribution psi tilde like this. It's one of these distributions I was talking about before. And and this is constant on Tm. So it's supported on zero and then on m times m, and it's given by this formula. This L t xi is the lead derivative of the vector field t xi on a function on the deformation normal cone, and you evaluate it at p comma p and s, and then you put zero for the tangent vectors. And you can see that this has all the good properties that you want. This is R plus star equivariant. Its evaluation at one is xi, is the original vector field. So this satisfies the theorem of Eric and Bob. And what about its symbol? Its symbol is actually the evaluation at zero. So it's given modulo smooth functions. Okay. So you have a very nice, this tangent groupoid, which is really a holonomy, the deformation normal cone, which is really a holonomy groupoid. It gives you both the operator and the symbol somehow. Okay, so let's go to the Kolmogorov plane. So this example I mentioned in the first slide, x squared plus y, where x, the blue vector field is dx and the y is x dy. It's just a simple exercise to see that the bracket is dy. So there's bound to be some Heisenberg group lurking around here. So what does it mean that this is a sum of squares? If you really want to see it as a sum of squares, you must assume that the order of the blue vector field is one and the order of the red one is two. So this forces the order of dy to be three somehow. And you can proceed in the, like in the previous way, in a very naive way, you can put, so now you're looking for this lift, t tilde. And because of the orders, you can, I mean, this is a nice guess for the orders, because I mean the powers of T, they come really from the orders. So you can ask the following these questions that are mentioned. What is the order of P tilde and where is the group point in all this? Is there some group point going around here? Okay, so let's see, let's do this in a better way. Again, this is the operator. So again, the order actually gives you a leaf filtration, which is singular now. I mean, you can take D1. D1 is the module, the C infinity M module generated by the blue vector field. D2 is the C infinity M module generated by the blue and the red vector field, vector fields. And D3 is all, of course, because of the bracket. But now this D1 and D2, they're not projective modules, so they're not sections of some vector bundle because of the singularities. They're just C infinity M modules of vector fields, which are, of course, they're finitely generated. And then you can actually cook up a new effoliation from all this by taking T D1, T squared D2. The tilde is, it means that you extend by the constant on, by zero at TM, at you know, at TM, so this is, in fact, this is a singular foliation because of the condition with the bracket. I mean, it's closed, it's involutive. It's very easy to see that it's involutive, and there is an R plus star action, which is given by this formula. Now let's see what happens when you restrict to various values of T. When you are away from T, when you are away from zero, when T is not zero, well, you can just divide by T and then you are left by D3, which is all the vector fields. So AD at away from zero is just all the vector fields. But at T equals zero, this is a simple exercise of algebra. You get this grading. So this is these quotients, this di mod di plus one. But now this, you have to remember that this is again a C infinity M module. These are not vector spaces. This is again a C infinity M module so far. Okay. So if we have a singular foliation, it must have a holonomy groupoid. So what is the holonomy groupoid? The holonomy groupoid is this object. So away from zero, it is just a pair groupoid. And at zero, you get these, at every point, you get this Lie algebra. This is a graded Lie algebra, which comes by localizing, actually it's written below. It comes by localizing this module at the point P. Localizing means here that I divide by the maximal ideal. This IP means the functions that vanish at the point P, okay? But now you have to be careful because, well, this when you divide every term of, when you take this quotient at every term of the filtration, then the induced maps are not going to be injective anymore because of the singularity. So to make a long story short, in fact, you will find that the grading, the group, I mean, will be at every point except zero, it will be R2, R plus R. But at zero, it will be exactly the Heisenberg group. So there is a jump of dimension, as you see at zero. So the symbol of the operator, what we expect, this is an expectation, it's not a fact. It will be commutative. We expect it to be commutative away from zero, but non-commutative just on the y-axis. Okay, and I will skip the last question, will come up later. Okay, so now we pass to more strict definitions. Let me tell you what is a singular foliation. This is the definition we gave with George Candalis several years ago. It is a C infinity M module of vector fields, which is involutive and locally finitely generated. And then we were able to prove that there is always a holonomy groupoid. It's a groupoid, in an algebraic sense. Its topology is usually very, very difficult, very bad. Well, actually it's a diffeological groupoid, whatever that means. But Claire Debord was able to prove that its fibers are always smooth. And we were able to prove that there is always a sister algebra. There is a reduced, actually there's also a full sister algebra, but we're going to be using the reduced one. Now, what does it mean for the foliation to be regular? Well, it means that the module is locally free. So it's the sections of some vector bundle. It's what you know. And what does it mean for foliation to be almost regular? It means that actually the module is projective. This is exactly the case. I'm sorry. So Claire was able to prove that she actually did this before our work, that when the foliation is almost regular, then the holonomy groupoid is a Lie groupoid. It's really a Lie groupoid in the almost regular case. Okay, now we can take these observations that we did with the previous examples and cook up a definition of a singular Lie filtration. So it's a filtration of modules now. The top one is going to be all the vector fields for the moment. So these are going to be locally finitely generated C infinity M submodules. And they satisfy this condition with a bracket, the usual condition. And of course, as we saw, every time I have a filtration like this, then I can cook up, there is a natural singular foliation that comes up in M times R. So this is what we call the adiabatic foliation. So what is the holonomy groupoid of that? Well, I just repeat what I said before. This part is a singular bundle. It's not really a bundle. It's just a union of graded Lie algebras, but they're always nilpotent. The dimension jumps. But there is always a sister algebra, and it is a C0R sister algebra. It's a C0R algebra. Okay. Now, let's talk about differential operators. This is what we want to do. So if we start with a singular Lie filtration like that, there is, we can consider the smallest filtration of differential operators. So what does this mean? Diff di is differential operators, which it's not, the I is not the order of the operators. It's really differential operators that are generated by vector fields in di. Okay, and of course we want this condition. We want, so what are the symbols here? The symbols is the, formally they are just this quotient, symbols of order I, just the quotient of differential operators of di, module differential operators of di minus one. And again, it's a module. And again, you would like to localize it at every point. You would want to divide by the maximal ideal. If you divide by the maximal ideal, it becomes this quotient. This is again an exercise. So you get a symbol map at every point, which lands here in this quotient. Okay. Now, let me give you an example. So let's take just a very simple example, the M just the real line, D1 to be X squared DX, and D2 to be just DX. And that I want to take the operator X DX. So this operator is in D2, but not in D1, okay? And then I have, so this is my map, my symbol map, my symbol of order 2. Now, this P lives in I0 of diff R, so it lives in the denominator at the point 0, so it's 0 at the point 0. And everywhere else, we can just divide by, locally, we can divide by X and X square, just locally, around the non-zero point, so that the right-hand side is completely 0. So this is an operator which has principal symbol of order, it's an order 2 in this calculus. Operator which has symbol 0 at every point, but it's not an order 1 operator. So it's not true that the kernel of the symbol map is the lower order, the order minus 1 operators as we usually have. This is what the singularities do. By the way, the grading, so the group in this case is R away from 0 and R2 at 0. Okay, again, the dimension jumps. Okay. Now there is an issue here that is important in order to understand the symbol of differential operators. Of course, there is a surjective map. There's a natural surjective map from the universal enveloping algebra of this grading, which is the module 2, to the formal symbols. And then when you localize it at P, you get this map. This map is again surjective. But can we really identify the right-hand side with the left-hand side? So does the principal symbol of P actually live in the universal enveloping algebra? So let me give you an example for this. So take the vector field X squared dx, then X dx, then dx, and you get, of course you get this filtration. And then you look at this operator XZ minus Y squared. And let's look at the order of this operator. The order in the filtration is of X is 1, of Z is 3, and the order of Y is 2. So the order of P is 4. But then if you calculate the operator, just do the algebra, you find that the operator is minus Y. So the order is 2. So you have dual orders. And on top of that, the group, this oscillating group at 0 is R3. So there is no way that this map can be injective. Okay. So this is what I say here in this slide, that the natural surjection is not injective. And the reason is the singularities. If you didn't have singularities, so in the context of the filtrations without non-singular filtration, like vector bundles, this map is going to be an isomorphism, but not in this case because of the singularities. There is a kernel, and the kernel is very important. It's we even gave it a name, characteristic ideal. Anyway, so let's see. Okay, so now, what should our goal be? Our goal should be to construct a calculus associated with the filtration, so that, in fact, there is an algebra homomorphism from the differential operators along the filtration to this calculus. And we want to prove a theorem which says that if you have a differential operator, then if the symbol is invertible, where should the symbol be invertible? Well, it should be not in every representation of the oscillating group, but in this quotient. So you need to cut a few representations which are represented by this kernel. Then there is a parametrics. Then you can find the parametrics. Okay. So let me tell you how we can build this calculus. Okay, as we said, the story is that we start with a singular leaf filtration, and then we have a singular foliation. Now, the fiber at a point, which is this Lie algebra, this osculating Lie algebra, you can model it by this graded Lie algebra, some graded Lie algebra, together with an R plus star action, which is given like this. And of course, you have, I mean, every element here, you can associate it to it a vector field, which lives in DI, and you want it to generate this DI, this sum to generate DI around the point. So this gives you an R plus star action on this product, on V times M times R. Okay. And in fact, what I'm going at is, I should tell you first what is the point. The point is, we are going to use the holonomy groupoid to build the calculus. The holonomy groupoid is the topology is very bad, but we know the building blocks of this topology. It's what is called by submersion. So we are trying to build, you can think of them as coordinates for this very bad groupoid. And I'm trying to build the coordinates for this particular singular foliation, the adiabatic foliation. So the coordinates near a point should look like this, should look like what is described in this slide. Okay, I will give some more details in the next slide. So this, I'm trying to build coordinates here. That's the motto. Okay, now, Now there are two maps. One is S is just the projection, and R is the exponentiation, you exponentiate. And then actually the coordinates is a smaller set than V times M times R, which is all the triples which in which the action is, norm of the action is smaller than one. First, there is some norm around. I don't want to get into that. Of course, because we are dealing with the R plus star action, we want the coordinates to be invariant by this action. And in fact, this fat u is invariant. And in fact, moreover, these two maps are R plus star equivariant. Okay. Now, the invariance by diffeomorphism is given by morphisms by submersions. This is what we call by submersion. So the triple fat U, S, and R. And the invariance by diffeomorphisms is the existence of an R plus R equivariant morphism between by submersions. Now, composition is given by the fiber product, the groupoid composition. But this again is tricky because you have to make sure that there are morphisms which preserve the action. And in fact also they keep track of the group. There is the group here in V. So anyway, this is a complicated story, but you can use the Baker-Campbell-Hausdorff formula I mean, you can find morphisms which realize the Baker-Campbell-Hausdorff formula over zero, which is actually the group. And then there are, you also have evaluations at one, you have push forward maps to M cross M and at zero, and you go to the gradient. To the oscillating Lie algebra. Okay, let me tell you what our operators are. So remember, we said that the pseudo-differential operator is really determined by its Schwarz kernel. So our operators are a subspace of Schwarz kernel of fiber distributions. So what is it? It is really distributions which you can actually lift. You can find a lift P tilde to some by submersion with these nice properties, which is the lift keeps track of the order. Okay. So of course you can read this definition, but the point is that these are the operators which, these are the distributions on M cross M, which admit a lift on some by submersion with all these nice properties. And this is really to be understood as the fact that the lift lives in the holonomy groupoid. Okay. It's on the coordinates. Okay, so, we can give a local expression for these operators of ours. You can prove, for this, you need to prove a lemma that there exists. This was actually already proven in the work of Eric Van Erp and Bob Junken, that you can actually find lifts which are continuous really on the nose for at t bigger than one or less than minus. And then doing standard things from Taylor, you can give this local expression. So this alpha, this A is a full symbol in some sense. So we have a nice formula for these operators. And we have an algebra. So if I take all these operators, then the smooth functions live on M cross M live there. And you have the standard properties. The K order are inside the K plus one order. The minus infinity orders, order operators are smooth functions. And you have the composition. And also you have adjoints. I don't want to get in. So indeed, you have an algebra. Now, in this algebra, we're able to state the Rockland condition. The Rockland condition for differential operators is that at each point, the symbol is invertible in every representation of this quotient. Okay. The symbol of these operators is what I defined before, of the differential operators is what I defined before. And then we're able to prove this theorem that if you have a differential operator which satisfies the Rockland condition, then you can find the parametrics in this calculus. Now, more than that, we have the extension of zero order operators. If the order, so this is the real part, because the order can also be a complex number. If the order is negative, then your operator is in compact operators of L2 of M, in general in the sister algebra. If you have less, or the order is less or equal to zero, then you get a bounded multiplier. And if you have a strictly positive operator which satisfies the Rockland condition, in fact, you need the parametrics to prove this, then the closure of P is a regular multiplier. Regular means unbounded multiplier. It's in the sense of Baz and Julk with this property. So this is all that I want to say. So what is be left from this talk is that foliation theory is crucial here, because you can realize the oscillating groupoid as a holonomy groupoid. And then, thanks to bisubmersions, we can build the analysis that we want. The Rockland condition is important. The singularities force us to look at representations that live in a quotient of the universal event of big algebra. Not, we cannot take all the representations. I should also say that we can generalize all this with to filtrations where the top term is not all the vector fields, but it's an almost regular foliation. Perhaps with a bit more effort, even for every regular, we can put a singular foliation, just an arbitrary singular foliation. But I don't know if this is interesting enough. And of course, as I said in the beginning, this is still work in progress. So we are investigating how to compute explicitly representations involved in the Rockland condition. There is a chance that they are related with quadrant orbits of these oscillating groups. But these are questions for later. So yeah, I will stop here. And yeah, thank you for your attention.
Thank you. Do you have any questions or comments?
So, may I ask? Is there kind of deformation quantization related to this calculus? Like when you have this integral formula and you put h in the denominator and expand in h or something, do you get some deformation over power series in h?
The short answer is I don't know, but an interesting question. It's something. Yeah, that should be investigated. Again, it's the representations that are involved are not the entire universal developing algebra. That's one needs to take care of this somehow. That's my feeling.
What do you mean by deformation quantization in the classical pseudo-differential calculus?
Classical, you know, so say over, I don't know, Rn. You have a function on the cotangent bundle on R2n, and you write a kernel where the exponential, you know, you put h in the denominator. It's the kernel is the Fourier transform, you know, and where you have e to the power I something in the Fourier transform, you put h in the denominator. And then you get an operator depending on h to any function on the cotangent bundle. And when you multiply or compose those two, you have the asymptotics at h equal to zero is a power series in h. So now you have a power series in h, which is an associative product on functions on the cotangent bundle. And that's deformation quantization of the cotangent bundle.
Yeah.
This is more or less the idea behind the work of Davor and Skondalis.
But this is by deformation quantization. You mean by power series? Not it does not converge. Uh-huh. Right?
Power series.
So here we are. It's an interesting question because. First of all, here we're working with sister algebra, so we have convergence.
Yes.
But I think there is an effort, maybe by Alberto Cataneo and collaborators, to find a middle, something in the middle between convergence and non-convergence. So related, there is a paper by Eli Hawkins. He combines, symplectic realizations with deformations, normal cone, and sister algebras, and they try to carry out a program like that. Because I think, so to be completely honest, of course, deformation quantization is one thing, But one issue is to calculate the spectrum. I think if you want to calculate spectrum, you need the convergence somehow.
Yeah, I think so.
So, yeah, so this, I mean, with this work, we're not there yet, but I don't know if in general we are there yet. But some people are thinking about this, as far as I know.
Okay, yeah, thanks.
Can I ask just about something related to what you were talking about at the very beginning? Which is that the original work of people like Rockland and Linda Rothschild and, you know, lots of people who worked on this business of Heisenberg calculus and so on, they actually got conditions for hypoellipticity and sort of strong information about differential operators by using the representation theory of the graded nilpotent Lie algebra that sort of comes out of the analysis.
Yes.
So question was, I mean, this is a really interesting idea, what you have here, to do the same thing, but to allow singular foliations where the thing can degenerate. So the question was, are there any sort of concrete cases where you can get kind of new concrete examples of hypoelliptic operators that are different from the sorts of examples that were already studied back then, you know, in the 70s and 80s and so on?
Yeah, so the idea behind this project is the following. You take a linear differential operator of your choice, and you look at the terms, you look at the order of the terms, you cook up a filtration. And then you put this machinery to work. You build this calculus, and then you have the Rockland condition. You apply the Rockland condition to your original operator, and you check if you can construct the parametrics. You check if it is Fred-Holm and so on. And the idea is to go beyond, really to go beyond the sums of squares and things like that. And there are examples. I put very simple examples for the talk in order to illustrate the ideas. But yes, there are other examples of linear operators that are not sums of squares, which you can fit into this. But this is work in progress. So we don't yet have a concrete computation of the representations involved. This is important. But the idea, yes, it is really to go beyond sums of squares.
One simple thing you could do, Jonathan, is so the Hallmander sums of squares theorem applies only to order two operators. So you could take an analog of a sums of squares operator where you have, say, sums of fourth powers or something like that. So that's just a toy model. I'm not sure whether those kinds of operators appear in concrete, you know, in physical applications or anything like that, but there are certainly now oodles of other operators that you can concoct that fit into this calculus that don't fit into Hallmander's theorem or the original Rockland theorem.
And I should also mention the names of Rothschild and Stein. I should really mention the work. I'm sorry it didn't appear in the slides, but it is part of the story also.
I also want to add that, so even if you consider the Kolmogorov operator on this, which appears on the slide, x dy minus dx squared, then of course its hypoellipticity follows from Hallmander's theorem.
Yes.
But let's say you want a parametrics to such an operator, or you want the principal symbol, then to my knowledge, all of the calculus defined, say, by Mellin, doesn't apply to this operator. And the reason is very simple. This is an operator on R2. In Mellin's case, the most general case before our work, it gives you a Lie group, which has the same dimension as the manifold. And in this case, the group would be a two-dimensional nilpotent group, so always commutative. But this group But this operator is hypoelliptic precisely because you have to insert the Heisenberg group somewhere. So you have to go to a higher dimensional group at some point. And that's precisely what happens in our, in the computations that Yakov was gave. On R2, the groups that we obtain are R2 at every point except the origin where you get the Heisenberg group. This is in contrast with Mellin, where the dimension of the group is constant.
Okay, thank you. Do we have any more questions? Or comments?
So I did Google osculating during the talk, so now I know what it means, but why such term?
Maybe Bob should answer this, because it comes from the work of...
No, it's not from it. So it goes back to the work of the people on the Heisenberg calculus, like Bills and Griner and so on, maybe even earlier. But the word osculating comes from kissing. So the idea is that instead of the tangential surface or the kissing surface to your manifold being a linear space, it's now something more complicated than nilpotent groups. So the local structure is now described by...
Thanks.
This is not Greek then, Yakovos. I guess it's Latin.
Yeah,
it's Latin.
No, it's not Greek. I'm pretty sure it's Latin. It's not Greek.
Okay.
Okay. Let's thank Yakov for a beautiful talk.
Yeah, and thank you for the invitation also. Yeah.
So, bye bye, everyone. Have a nice
week.
Bye.
Bye.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Bye.